Hey guys, welcome back to the Hello World Guy, and in this video we are going to do a couple of things, so let's quickly get started. Alright guys, so here you can see we have got Unity loaded up, and before we start I just want to tell you a really simple thing. You can see that I am not seeing any axis lines or anything else here. That's because I have turned off the floor here. By clicking this icon you can see I can turn it off on again if I want, but I don't really want that. And I have also turned off the gizmos, these icons, by clicking this, so that you can see I don't really see this camera and stuff here. I just prefer to have it this way. It's up to you. You can do whatever you like. You have got a bunch of other options. You can, you know, change this, the field of view of this camera. You can like make it really low field of view, and then, you know, this is kind of weird. So yeah, there are a bunch of things. I'm going to just leave it at the default settings, and if I look around you can see there's my object here. And okay, so that out of the way, let's get starting adding our death screen. That's the first thing I want. And moreover, we are also going to add a health bar and then a blood splash effect to our player. So first of all, the death screen. For that, I'm going to create a new canvas. The reason I'm doing it on the separate canvas is so that we can enable and disable it whenever we want. I'm going to call this the death screen. And then what I'm going to do here is go under the name view. I'm going to right click on the death screen, and I'm going to go under UI and add in an image to it. This image will represent our background. So of course we can't just have a death screen without a background. And this is basically going to be a black image with an opacity of something like 70. And then I'm going to go under the anchors, and I'm going to select the stretch on both axes so that it covers the whole screen at all times. Okay, with that done, I'm going to maybe just make it 80 instead of 70, just a little darker, maybe 75. That's a good. Okay, with that done, I'm going to right click on the death screen, and I'm going to go under UI, and I'm going to add in a button. Okay, this is going to be called play again, and just call it restart button. Restart button. And but I'm going to go under here and change the text of this, so this is a separate object, to be restart. And make sure to select the death screen and the sort order to something like 1, so that you know it is not on top of you know, it's on top of the other canvas which we have got here. So we can select the text here, and then I'm going to increase its font size to something like 64, or maybe just 48. And then what I'm going to do is select my restart button and increase its width to something like 200 and height to something like 60. That works. I'm going to decrease the position Y to negative 50, and I'm going to right click in here, add in a new text element, not to the restart button but instead to the death screen. This is going to be a 0. Okay, and I'm going to make sure that it's in the center, it's aligned in the center, and I'm going to just make it something like game over. And then I'm going to change the color to be red, and then I'm going to increase the font size. I'm also going to make sure that it's stretched only on horizontally, not vertically. By selecting this option, it's in the center horizontally but stretched vertically, so that we can increase its hair, but we don't need to worry about how large or small the size might be, only the height. But is that even, that's not a problem really. So I'm going to set this to something like 100. And I'm going to increase its position to something like 50. And that I think works. So now what you can do is, yeah, that's pretty much it. Maybe I'll just change this to 75, or yeah, that's pretty good. And now what I'm going to do is actually just select this death screen object, and I'm going to turn it off so that we don't see it in the start, of course. So now I'm going to open a Visual Studio, and you can see we have got our own death function here. I'm going to first of all replace this with a curly brackets function so that we can add more statements here. And what I'm going to do here is we want to do a couple of things. So first of all, I will have a couple of references here. So I will create a game object here called the death screen, because UI elements are just normal game objects and you can do it like this. And I think I have got the variables already here. I think I added them before I started recording the video. So this is the mouse. We have got two variables here, serialized look. One is of type mouse look, which is going to be attached to the camera. we are going to disable the mouse look and player movement script along with the shooting script so that the player cannot shoot or move or do any of that when he's dead, of course. We don't want that. And the death screen is just a game object which we are going to enable. So in the start function, you can see I'm already setting the death screen to be non-active, so that if it's maybe we forgot to disable it inside of the inspector, or it is disabled when the game starts. So in here, what we are going to do is go to death screen dot set active, and we are going to set it to true. And then we are going to set enabled is equal to false on this object so that the shooting script is disabled. And then we are going to say get component player movement dot enabled is equal to false as well, because we don't want the player to move when he's dead. And also we want to disable the mouse look, so we have got a reference to that. The reason we can't use get component is because it's attached to the camera, not to the player itself, and the shooting script is attached to the player. So yeah, that's pretty much it for the on death function. Now if I go under Unity and I'm going to select my player here, and I'm going to attach the death screen here, and you can see I've already attached the main camera to the mouse look. So just drag the main camera inside of the mouse look because it's got a mouse look script on it, as you can see. Okay, so when I hit play now, if I actually go in front of the enemy, it should work. So now if I just jump and go in front of the enemy, you can see my health is decreasing. It's in 50, 40, 30, 25, 20, 10, and when it's over, then everything works. But you can see that my mouse is still locked and I can't move it unless I hit escape, and then it gets locked again. So in order to fix that, just go here and say cursor dot lock mode. Lock state is equal to cursor lock mode dot none. With that done, it should work. But of course, currently the actual restart button is not functioning. So in order to do that, I'm going to right click here and create a new C# script called UI event. Now this will handle all of the UI events. It will basically contain a bunch of public functions that we can hook up to the appropriate events. And this will contain the UI event for all of our UI elements, including the main menu and stuff. So it will just contain a series of public voids that we can attach to our buttons whenever we want. So the first one is going to be restart, which is going to restart the game. For that, we need to use the Unity engine dot scene management namespace. And in here, what we can do is go scene manager dot load scene, and here we are going to say scene manager. We are going to provide it with a build index, which is going to be scene manager dot get active scene, the scene we are currently playing, dot build index. So they should essentially load the current scene, which should effectively restart the game. In the final game, we might open up the main menu or anything or something like that. So in here, I'm going to right click and create an empty game object called UI event. And I'm going to just attach my UI event script to it, like that. And now I can go under my restart button. And in here, we have just got a Unity event, like we created our custom one. And we can add a new thing here, new function here, new callback. And I can attach UI events to this object. And for the function, I can go under UI events and to the restart function. Now, at this point, if I hit play, everything should function. So if I hit play, you can see that the game starts, and I can go in front of the enemy and he starts to attack me, and I can attack him as well. And you can see my health is decreasing, and once it's over, we have got this, and I can hit restart to again start the game. So that's pretty good. Alright, so now we are going to add the health bar. Now, it's not really that simple, to be honest. But what you can do is, if I go under my canvas and I'm going to right click here, and you can see I am going to go under here and I'm going to go under UI, and you might be tempted to add in a scroll bar. But I think the better way to do it would be to use just an image. I'm going to call this the health bar. And maybe we should rename our images correctly. I'm going to call this one the this is of course the crosshair, of course. And what I'm going to do with this health bar is I'm going to go under the rect transform, and I'm going to move it to the bottom left corner. then I'm going to increase its position on the x and the y to be 100 by 100, which is pretty, okay, not really 100 by 100, maybe 75 by 75. Okay, and then I'm going to decrease its height to be something like 50 or 60, and then I'm going to decrease its position on the y a bit as well, like 50, or really we could make it 65. No, I think 50 is fine. And then I'm going to increase its width to something like 200, and then increase its position on the x. Maybe the width should be more like 250, and I think that looks like pretty good. But I'm going to decrease the height to 50. Yes, you just play around with these values until you find something that you like, and I'm going to change this to 150. Okay, so this is going to be the background for our health bar. Now what I'm going to do now is and as you can see, it currently the image has got none in here, so yeah, that's basically like a square. So I'm going to right click in the health bar, go under UI, and I'm going to add in another image. This is going to be the fill image, and what this is going to be, I'm going to change the anchor to be stretch, then I'm going to change its color to be completely green, then these values I'm going to have 10 and 10 and 10 and 10 in all of them. Maybe 10 is a bit too much. Yeah, that would actually cause it to be 20, because you know it's two sides. And now you can see we have got a kind of fill thing here, but of course we cannot actually change it. So in order to do that, what I'm going to do is this, go under this image here, and in here you can see we have got just a normal image but nothing more. But if I go under I cannot find that option for some reason. If I select the source image, just like if I select any source image, then we will get this image type option. So for that we actually need to select the source image. So in order to do that, what I'm going to do is go under just the external asset, and we want to have a square basically. Now you could go ahead in Photoshop and just draw a square and import it in Unity if you wanted to, but what I'm going to do is go under Window and then Package Manager, and then go under the package, make sure that this is selected as Unity Registry, then select 2D Sprite Package and just install that. You can see I have already done that, therefore it's now saying remove for me, but just install the package. And then once you have done that, what should happen is that now you should be able to go under here, create and 2D, and you should be able to create a square pretty easily. And then select the square and make sure that it is select, it is the type is 2D and UI. Now if I go under the fill here, and I'm going to drag the squares right in here, you can see we have got this. And in the image type here, I am going to change this to filled. Now in the fill method, change that to horizontal, because of course you are, and now you can see I can change this fill amount as much as I want, and that effectively is like a health bar, isn't it? Now that is like a health bar. So now of course we need to program it so that it's actually like a health bar. Now, in order to actually make the health bar actually reflect our current health, what I'm going to do is go under my damageable class, and in order to allow these fields, the max health, default health, etc., to be accessed from outside, I'm going to add a bunch of read-only properties, just paste them, and you can see that this is health, which gets health, and default health, and just like that. And I haven't added any setters because I do not want these to be modified from outside. So these are public of course, but there is no setter, these are read-only properties. And what I can do by going under shooting, and what I can do here is, first of all, I will use a namespace here called using Unity engine.ui. Now after doing that, I can go here and, serialize view. And then I'm going to create a private image of type image. I'm going to create a variable of type image, and this is going to be called the fill image. And this is essentially the image that we use for filling. And what I can do here is go under the update method, and here I can say damageable is equal to get component damageable. And here what I can do now is say I can say that the fill image dot fill amount is equal to basically damageable dot health divided by damageable dot max health. Now that should work. So this gives us a value from 0 to 1 representing our current health, like a percentage. Now if I go under Unity and hit play at this point, of course we forgot one thing. We actually need to select the player, and then we need to drag the fill, and remember the fill, not the health bar, the fill image into this fill image variable. And if I run the game now, then what you should see is that as soon as the game starts, it jumps, the health bar jumps to 100%, and you can see that the enemy is able to damage me now. And as you can see, he is damaging me. Okay. So yeah, you can see it's basically working. And you can see that the script gets stopped correctly. So now all is left to add is a blood splash animation. So what am I going to do for that? So first of all, you can see we've got our animations folder here already, which contains two animations that we don't need. I'm going to delete those. Let's make sure that the anime object doesn't have any of those. I mean, if I go under the GFX, it's got an animator actually, so I think we should remove that. Okay, so here what I'm going to do is I'm going to go under my canvas. I'm going to right click, add in a UI image. I'm just going to call it blood splash, and you can use a texture if you want. If you got like an online texture, you can just download it and use that. But I'm going to just put a plain red thing, and I'm going to go under and make it stretched at the hole, and then we are basically going to go under the color, and then I'm going to make it completely transparent. That's it. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to right click and create so you can do it that way, but I'm going to select my blood splash animation, go under window. You can just hit Control 6 by the way to open up the animation window. It's a good idea to use keyboard shortcuts. I mean, come on, you want to waste time. And here I'm going to hit create, and I'm going to choose my animation folder, and I'm going to call this one blood splash, and that should create an animation. And what I'm going to do is at the start, there it is. We have got, so I'm going to hit record. By the way, I'm just going to show you another way to do this. You don't need to hit record, you can just go add property under image, under color. You can add the color property here. And what you can do is you can see that everything is set here at the default values, and it ends at 1, add those values. So, what I can do is go under 30, which you remember these are 60 frames. So, 1 second is 60, which is here, and 30 is half a second. So, here I can go under the alpha and I can make it something like 0.5 or 0.5. Six. Okay, and if I play the animation, you can see what it looks like. But I think it's a bit too slow, so I'm going to move this to 15 while moving the final keyframe to 30, which means this animation will only last half a second, which is a pretty small amount for an animation really. But that's pretty cool what we are going to do. And yeah, so what I'm going to do now is preview the animation, and you can see it looks pretty good. So yeah, that's I guess awesome. And the problem is currently that our robot is actually attacking more often than this animation's length. What you can do is make the animation even shorter, and that's actually what I can do. But you can also just, you know, tweak the attack duration of the robot. You know, might make it 0.5 seconds so that the animation gets a chance to play properly. But you can just make it 0.3 seconds by reducing this down. Yeah, 20. That's exactly 0.3 seconds. So I think that's pretty awesome. And what I'm going to do now is, of course, go under the animator by going over here and opening a blood splash animator. And here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to right click, and just as we did before, I'm going to create an empty state called dummy here. And I'm going to make a transition from. I'm going to right click, actually not make a transition. I'm going to right click on it and make it the default, come on, right click and set as layer default state. And after the blood splash animation is finished, I'm going to drag that into the dummy animation. And for the transition duration, I'm going to make sure that it is 0 so that the transition is instantaneous, and the exit time should be 1 so that the whole animation plays. Alright, with that done, we can just, I'm just going to call it splash. Instead of blood splash, that would be a bit easier to type in code, I guess. So now what I'm going to do is open up the player again, and now here we get a little bit of a problem. The point is that we are setting this in update, alright, but we need to actually be damaged and know when the player is damaged in order to actually display the damage animation. For that, we are going to use, you guessed it, yet another Unity event. Now, Unity events are basically events that have no arguments. So if you want to do arguments, you will have to create your own class. So I'm going to just create a public class here called damage event. And this is going to be inheriting from Unity event, and you can actually specify a type here. This is a generic class, and I can just say float and float, which means that it will take two float arguments, and that's exactly what we want. We want it to take two arguments, actually not two arguments, just one argument. This one argument will represent how much damage we actually receive. We might need this in later, even though we don't now, but you know, it's a good idea to have that. Like, you know, you can make the animation more intense depending on what how much damage it is, but we are not going to do that. I'm going to just create damage event or on damage. Actually, I'm going to rename this to be on death instead of on death event. Okay, so now what we are going to do is go under here, and every time we take damage, I'm going to say on damage dot invoke. And of course, we need to give it an argument, which is going to be our damage. Alright, that's pretty much it. So I can go under the shooting now, and I can add in a public void here. Public void on damage. And then I can have in a float here called float called damage. And what I can do here is basically, okay, so for that we actually need to have a, so I will have a reference to a private animator called I will call it blood slash animator. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is get that blood slash animator. I'm going to dot play, and then I'm going to, for the name, I'm going to say state. We call it splash, if you remember. So that's pretty much it. So if I let it compile, and then I go under Unity, okay. And now I can select my player. I can drag the blood splash object in here because that has got an animator attached to it. And now if I hit play, it should actually just work perfectly. So if I go under here, so if I go in front, oh, object reference not set to an instance, where, okay, on damage or invoke, huh, that's the problem. Okay, let's see. Okay, of course we haven't got any actual, okay, let me select the player, and you can see we have got on death here, which is currently just empty. Oh, and the reason it is empty is that we actually need to so this is currently null because it's not serialized by Unity. Even though this is a serialized serial, do that because we are using a custom class, we need to mark this as system.serializable. Now if I do that and go under Unity, then it should work actually, hopefully. And as you can see, and it has actually also resetted our own death function, so I think I will have to get that back by adding this shooting object here, and then going into player movement, shooting, and on death. And in here I can add another one, and I can drag the shooting script in here as well. And as you can see, if I go under shooting, I get my own damage function, and I can use that. And it's asking me to specify a specific value for that, but I'm not going to do that because of course it will work automatically. So now if I hit play, hopefully it will work. So if I go in front of him, you can see he's coming towards me, and when he comes towards me, the animation starts to play, so it's a bit too intense. Okay, you know, the enemy is attacking a bit way too fast for now. I think what I'm going to do is go to the enemy and make his attack delay 0.75 maybe, and then I will change his damage to be 10. So that should work. So if I, you know, these are just kind of decisions that you can make on your own. Decide what your game wants. Decide what you want your game to be like. I mean, it's up to you completely. And if I go here, he's still kind of trying to push me because he comes a bit too close. I think. So he comes a bit too close, that's our problem. And I think there is still something that we can fix, but yeah, that pretty much works for now. I'm going to just select the enemy and make his stopping distance 3 again. Let's see if it works. So if I just go in front of him. Oh, he's actually not working for some reason. Okay, he is. And he's doing damage and... Okay. So yeah, you can see that's pretty much working, and I guess this is it for this video. So in the next video, we will actually do a bunch of new things. But I hope you enjoyed this one. Also consider subscribing to the channel, because most of you aren't subscribed. So yeah, subscribe. So I will see you in the next video, and bye.